Good morning, good afternoon, and for some of you, good evening. We have a very diverse audience in attendance today. Would you like to welcome all of you to Sutter's ongoing webinar series, Scientists Empowering Scientists. Today's talks, Dynamic Clamp and Cross-Experiment Analysis. My name is Telly Galeatsatos from Sutter Instruments Sutter Patch team, and I'll be your moderator for today's talks. Before we get started, I would like to take care of some housekeeping items. Hopefully everyone can hear me. If you are experiencing audio issues and your computer is equipped with either speakers or headphones, please check volume settings and any cable connections. If your computer is not equipped with speakers or are still having issues hearing me, then you could join the conference by telephone. All you need to do is select telephone as the audio source on the webinar control panel and dial into one of the international numbers shown on this slide. These phone numbers are also available by clicking on the additional numbers link, as you see in the control panel screen. To join the conference, you will also need to enter the webinar access code, which is 839-614-181, as shown here. If you have questions, use the Q&A section in your session control panel. Please mention which speaker your question is directed to. All questions will be addressed either during the Q&A session, at the end of the webinar, or offline by email. Documentation material is available for this webinar. PDFs of the presentation slides are available for download from the handout section in the webinar control panel as shown here. This webinar is being recorded. The video recording will be available on the Sutter Instrument YouTube channel. For our customers in China, it will also be available on Youku. The video recording should be available within the next 2 weeks. Everyone who registered for this webinar will receive an email notification once the recordings do become available. Finally, at the conclusion of this webinar, you will be redirected to a brief two-question survey asking if you would like to be added to our email distribution list or if you would like for us to contact you. I would now like to introduce my colleagues and today's speaker. Our first speaker is Greg Hempstead. Greg completed his electrical engineering degree from Duke University in 1988. Greg then went on to complete his PhD in neuroscience in 1997 at the University of California at San Francisco, where he remained until the end of 2013 as an adjunct faculty in the neurology department. In 2014, Greg joined Sutter as a lead design engineer. Our next speaker, Jan Dolzer, completed his PhD in biology from the Philipps University of Marburg in Germany. In 2003, Jan joined Axon Instruments and stayed through a number of corporate mergers until 2011, when he joined Sutter as the product manager for laser-based micropipette pullers. In 2012, Jan joined Heka Electronic as their vice president of sales and marketing. It was during his time at Heka that Jan and I first started working together. In 2014, Jan returned to Sutter as the product manager for patch clamp systems. Our agenda for today. I'm already in the middle of introductory remarks. I will then give an overview of our patch clamp systems. I realize that this information may be repetitive for you, so I will try to be brief. Greg will then give his talk on dynamic clamp modeling conductances with a deep patch amplifier system. Jan will follow with his talk on cross-experiment analysis using our Sutter Patch software. At the conclusion of Jan's talk, we will have a question and answer session. And finally, at the end of the webinar, you will be redirected to our survey. Many of you are already aware of Sutter's extensive product line, which includes filament and laser-based micropipette pullers, micromanipulators and microscope stages and platforms, imaging light sources, specialized microscopes. We also carry the TMC tables and Faraday cages, perfusion systems from Automate Scientific, microinjection systems, and finally, our newest product line, patch clamp systems. All of these products allow us to provide complete turnkey systems. So let's get started with our patch clamp systems. We introduced the IPA and the Sutter Patch software in the fall of 2015. A year later, it was followed by the double IPA. All of the IPA family members share the same specifications, which is fully integrated patch clamp amplifier and data acquisition system for quick and easy setup, They support both wholesale voltage and current clamp experiments. They support master-slave combination with other instrumentation, and they use a single USB connection. One thing that many people are not aware of is that multiple IPA amplifiers can be connected and are fully supported in the Sutterpatch software to provide additional fully synchronized channels. They can be used in a broad range of wholesale and current clamp applications. This is a list of some of the common applications. The newest member to the IPA family is the Dendrite Data Acquisition System. The Dendrite is a standalone digitizer for upgrading systems that already have conventional amplifiers. Next up is our Tesla Model S, the D-Patch ultra-fast low-noise amplifier system. The D-Patch is also an integrated system with a built-in digitizer. It is available with either one or two head stages, but unlike the IPA, the main unit remains the same. Each D-Patch pre-amplifier head stage unit, as shown here, has its own dedicated high-speed AD and D-to-A converter and an EEPROM that stores its calibration constants. The pre-amplifiers are not matched to the main unit, so they can be easily moved around or replaced as needed. Here are basic feature highlights of the D-Patch. The D-Patch was designed for optimal noise performance and very high bandwidth. This is achieved by replacing most of the analog circuitry by an FPGA and an ARM core processor. Basically, the D-Patch lives in the digital domain. The three main points that I would like to showcase is that it has two resistive and one capacitive feedback range. It is FPGA controlled and has built-in computing power, and that it is field upgradable. In fact, the dynamic clamp functionality was an add-on which was made available to all our D-Patch customers via free firmware upgrade, which is handled directly from the Sutterpatch software. The D-Patch is a laboratory workhorse that can handle a variety of patch clamp experiments, including low noise single channel, nanopore, and specialized high bandwidth applications. All of our systems are controlled via our Sutterpatch software. Sutterpatch is a fully featured electrophysiology data acquisition, management, and analysis application for Windows and Mac OS computers, and is completely powered by Wavemetrics Igor Pro 8. Some of the features of Sutterpatch are scope window and a data navigator that provides intuitive, efficient data navigation review, membrane test, routine editor, which basically allows you to define all your acquisition types, including sweep-based, continuous, or so-called gap-free data acquisition with and without complex output waveforms, and or real-time analysis. Paradigms enable process automation and control. We have a variety of built-in analysis modules, including mini synaptic event detection, single channel, action potential characterization, capacitance measurements, so-called software lock-in, virtual signals, real-time measurements and graphs, as well as access to all of Igor's built-in functions. Sutterpatch has over 600 metadata parameters that are stored along with the data. And since we are built on top of Igor Pro, we also have publication quality output directly from within the software. So the main highlight here that sets Sutterpatch apart from the other software packages available is the amount of analysis modules that are built in and possibility to do publication quality output directly without having to do any kind of export. If you would like to get a demo version of Sutterpatch, it is available at our website, sutter.com. One thing I like to make clear, and it still seems like a lot of people are not quite aware, that all of the Sutter amplifier systems, including the Dendrite, are sold as a bundle. And by that, I mean that you have everything that you need to get started is included, which includes the device itself. In case of the amplifiers, you will also get a model cell and pipette holders, an Igor license, and the Sutterpatch software. And it's only sold as a bundle. We have been compiling a list of publications that use our amplifier systems. If you would like to be included, please send us an email or contact us. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge all of the people that make this possible, from our hardware engineers, Greg Helmstead, Rich Lobdell, Aaron Best. Greg is responsible for the IPA family of amplifiers and has also been a key member on the D-Patch hardware team. And our Stutterpath software team, again, Greg is very busy. He's on that team as well. In addition to Hubert Alfalter, Bert Martz, Jan Dolzer, Lindsay Dong, who's no longer with Sutter, but an integral part in the Sutter Patch development, and lastly, myself. And with that, I'd like to pass it over to our first speaker, Greg Hampstead.
Thank you all very much for tuning in today. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to discuss the newest feature of Sutter Patch, that is our dynamic clamp module for the D-Patch amplifier system. And what I'm going to do today is I'm going to basically walk you through how you set up a dynamic clamp experiment. And in that process, I think what we'll see is why we believe that the D-Patch is really well suited for these sorts of experiments. But first, before we get into that, I want to take a little bit of time to review exactly what dynamic clamp is and go through some of that a little bit. Dynamic clamp as a technique was first introduced more than 25 years ago by two separate groups. And what exactly is dynamic clamp? Well, if we think of a voltage clamp experiment, and what we do in a voltage clamp experiment is decide what voltage we want to be at and inject and then measure whatever amount of current is required to be able to maintain that voltage. A current clamp experiment, instead, we inject a fixed amount of current and we just measure the voltage that the cell is at. Well, in a dynamic clamp experiment, similar to current clamp, we're measuring the voltage, but instead we inject a current that is a function of that measured voltage. So, for example, this is a typical equation that we might see for a current going through a ion channel. Basically, if we were to inject this current, if we imagine the reversal potential to be zero, this would be a simple leak current, right? And again, the current is a function of the measured voltage. But in general, with dynamic clamp, the current injections tend to be quite a bit more complicated equations than that. What you might have is a sum of currents, of a sum of different channels that we're modeling. And importantly, the conductance is a function of voltage. Those equations can get relatively complicated. At this point, I'm often asked, well, what sort of an experiment would you actually do in dynamic clamp? Why would I want to use this technique? And I'm going to take a step back just for a second. This is a figure that I borrowed from a Trends in Neurosciences article from a while ago, but it's a very good review of dynamic clamp. Here's one possible experiment. You're measuring an ion channel of interest. You could block that channel using a pharmacological agent. And then with dynamic clamp, what we could actually do is, in essence, rescue that current. We inject the current from our amplifier and see if we can mimic what we had initially. This would tell us, for example, if our pharmacological block was actually specific for the channel of interest. Likewise, you could imagine a similar experiment in a knockout mouse where you could rescue a channel in just one cell. And this allows you to dissociate effects that are happening on the cell of interest as opposed to potentially network effects or developmental effects that might be happening due to your knockout. A second type of experiment that you could do is instead a subtraction experiment. Here, again, we're recording a current of interest. And with our dynamic clamp, what we could actually do is have a negative conductance. So manage to block the ion channel effects without the need for a pharmacological blocker. So again, if a drug wasn't available to block your channel, that would be one use for this. Or likewise, to be able to, again, take something out in just a single cell, whereas the pharmacological drug would be affecting every cell in your, if you were doing in a slice, and could, again, dissociate network effects from what's going on in your given cell. But whatever sort of experiment we're doing, it really requires that we can, one, model the current of interest, and two, that we can accurately recreate that current in the cell through our dynamic clamp. And this is where dynamic clamp gets difficult. This is the challenge, because again, if we look back at the simple equation we have for our current injection, if we imagine, let's model, for example, a sodium channel. And this is based on work that was done by Hodgkin and Huxley back in the 1950s. A sodium conductance basically can be modeled as being governed by two different gates, an activation gate, an M gate, and an inactivation gate, H. Essentially, the activation, you need three particles to be activated, and then the channel will actually open and conduct. But even for one of these gates, the equations are non-trivial. So what we have is a differential equation that needs to be solved. I'm not going to go through the math other than to show that it's a little bit complicated. And what's the important point to take home here is that this differential equation, to be able to solve this and to be able to, again, get an accurate recreation of the current, we need to, first of all, be able to do this math very, very fast. And second, it needs to have consistent timing. This delta T can't be changing and wobbling all over the place if we want to get an accurate estimation of what the actual sodium current is doing. And traditionally, that's been the challenge for dynamic clamp. The reason for that is that in a traditional setup, we've got our amplifier where we're making our recording of the voltage. And that signal has to go through a digitizer and come down to our computer or our device, our dynamic clamp device. And there's a real challenge here because there's a lot of time delays, especially on, say, Windows operating systems, where you can have significant delays as the computer is taking care of both the data acquisition, the dynamic clamp, and probably checking your email at the same time. So traditionally in dynamic clamp systems, getting high speed and maintaining that consistent timing can be very difficult. So what is different about the D-patch? Well, as Telly mentioned at the beginning of this talk, the D-patch is designed very differently. And that is the signal right away from the head stage is being digitized. We've got a analog to digital converter that is running nonstop at 5 megahertz, digitizing our signal. And that signal is being sent to an FPGA on the amplifier that has an associated ARM core. This is where most of the signal processing happens. It's where the signals are filtered, where we calculate out the capacitance neutralization or capacitance compensation, things like that. And once all of that signal processing is done out in the amplifier, then the final signal is being sent down over USB to our Sutterpatch software. So what you can immediately recognize is that if we can have our dynamic clamp module out here in the amplifier, we don't have to worry about this communication back and forth between the amplifier and the dynamic clamp module. And in fact, what we found is, whereas in traditional systems, oftentimes getting speeds of 40 or 50 kilohertz would be a gold standard, depending on the model that we use, we can actually reach speeds of 500 kilohertz as far as our update rates for our dynamic clamp. So what I'm going to do now is take us through a few of the different models that we have in Sutterpatch and walk you through how we would enter our coefficients for each of these models. And we have at this time 4 different dynamic clamp models, a Hodgkin-Huxley style gate model, as I described before, a Goldman-Hodgkin-Katz permeability model. I'm not actually going to talk about that today in the interest of time. We can enter Markov models, and then finally a variable conductance. This would be if you were trying to mimic, for example, a synaptic conductance. So let's start with the Hodgkin-Huxley model. What I'm showing you here is the dynamic clamp editor. And before we get into this, I'm going to just bring up a couple of points about how this works. If people have used or looked at Sutter Patch, our dynamic clamp editor is very similar to the routine editor that you would use for designing a single experiment. You can make a number of different models, enter in the parameters for that, and importantly, each of these are saved as pools, which means they're easy to duplicate. They're saved independent from the experiment. You can copy your dynamic pool, send it to a colleague in another country. They can open it up, load whatever experiment you were using before, and you guys can basically run the same experiment. On the main page of our dynamic clamp editor, this is where we choose the model. There's a mode where we can either run continuously or only during data acquisition. This is where you set the update rate and then select the voltage signal source. This is typically going to just be the head stage that you're using. There are also other choices. You can use the other head stage if you have a two head stage model. Perhaps you're doing a network study. There's also an aux out channel, and I'll get into describe that towards the end of my talk. So again, let's say we wanted to enter a Hodgkin-Huxley model. I've shown this equation before for a sodium channel. And what we basically need to do is enter the rate constants for each of the gates, the alpha and the beta. And basically, we just have a button for editing the model parameters. And here what you can do is you first select which channel, and you can have up to 8 different channels running simultaneously. And for each channel, you can have up to 16 gates. I think this is probably more than enough for any known channel. For each channel, first of all, we have to enter a reversal potential and also what the maximum open channel conductance would be. And then in the gate settings, first of all, you enter the exponent and then simply enter the alpha and the beta. You enter the rate constants. And these are entered simply as equations. You type in whatever you want, and it's going to be parsed by Sutter Patch. The one variable that we're allowed is V, which is read in millivolts. After we enter in the rate constants, first of all, for the M gate and the H gate, and for both sodium and potassium, come back to the main menu and simply press activate. And now the dynamic clamp is running. And this is the response that you would see to a 100 picoamp stimulus. So the blue line would be if the dynamic clamp was off, you would get a depolarization in your, this is in a model cell, and you'd see the time constant of the membrane as the membrane is being charged and depolarized. When the dynamic clamp is on, in fact, what we end up getting is a bunch of action potentials in an otherwise completely passive model cell. One of the cool things about living inside of Igor for Sutter Patch is when you enter those equations, rather than entering it as an equation, it's possible to enter a call to an Igor function. Why might we do this? Oftentimes people, when they're entering in gate equations, they say, well, I've got values for my steady state activation and activation time constants. I don't know the alphas and the betas. And while these variables are interchangeable, as you see here, it's not always trivial to be able to calculate out what this would be. So in fact, here, this is an example that I've shown of a way to be able to convert from one to the other. And simply what we do is we call an Igor function that you write. These are called instead of parsing the equation, and it allows you to come to the same output as you would otherwise. This is just to show basically for people who have experience programming inside of Igor, really the sky's the limit as far as the power and the capabilities that you have. So what if we wanted to do this as a Markov model as opposed to a Hodgkin-Huxley gate model? So a Markov model, essentially what you have is a number of different states that your channel can be in. You've got closed states, perhaps open states. You could have inactivation states. In fact, this is a Markov representation of that same Hodgkin-Huxley sodium channel that we've been looking at before. And in fact, any gate model can be viewed or modeled as a Markov model. The opposite isn't necessarily true. But between any two states, there are rate equations. And when this Markov model is solved, basically all of these rate equations are simultaneously solved and updated. How would we get this data into SutterPatch? Oh, before I get there, I would just want to say how we solve this. I'm not going to go into the details about that, but essentially I would point you to a chapter that was written by David Calhoun and Alan Hawks that provides all of the mathematics behind how to actually solve these Markov models. Also, Lauren Malescu has some papers that go through different ways of solving Markov models, and this is a very good resource too. But anyway, if we wanted to enter in the data from our Markov model, we have a list of rate equations for each of these places, and what we're going to do is create a state matrix. And the rate equation for any two states is going to go into the appropriate rows and columns of that state matrix. So, for example, this equation here is the rate from going from state one to state two. And so we're going to fill that in the first row and second column of our state matrix. To get it there, again, this is from the Dynamic Lamp editor. This is the screen that we would look at. Again, we would select our channel. The reversal potential would be similar to what we had before, and we have to select the number of states for this given channel, and it can be anywhere up to 14. And again, depending on the size of these channels, we can have up to 8 different channels being modeled simultaneously. So what we'll do here is enter in each of the possible equations in this list over here on the left. And the reason we do this is oftentimes you'll have the same equation being used in more than one place. So it's only necessary to enter that equation in once, and then it can be placed into the state matrix anywhere that it needs to go. And what we do is we basically press the state matrix button, it pops up a matrix like this, and then the given state equation that we want this one to go into row one, column two, and basically just press that button and it pops. A couple of additional parameters that need to be entered. Each state is going to have an open channel conductance. In this case, our open channel was state three. And likewise, we have to start up with an initial probability vector. In this case, we're just going to start in the first closed state. When we activate this model, you'll see this graph looks very, very similar to what it was for the Hodgkin-Huxley. In fact, it's more or less indistinguishable between the two models. The last model that I want to talk about here is the variable conductance model. This is a little bit different in the way that we implement it. But essentially, again, for a variable conductance, rather than having the conductance be a function of voltage, we want this conductance to be a function of time. And typically, this sort of a model is used when we want to mimic a synaptic conductance that changes over time. So for example, we might be wanting to mimic a GABAergic input onto our neuron. The settings in the dynamic clamp panel are very straightforward. Basically, all we need to do is enter in the reversal potential. And I'll just mention that you can, in fact, have multiple conductances going at the same time. So you could have a second one if you wanted to. But where we define our conductance stream, in fact, is in the routine editor, because this is part of the routine that you're going to run. And so when we set up the experiment using the routine editor, and this is where we define our input channels, where we define the stimulus that we're applying to the head stage, where we're applying our real-time measurements, et cetera, we can also create a conductance stream. And this conductance stream is defined in the same way that our stimuli are defined with different segments. And importantly, when we define these segments, these output channels all accept a template. Templates are very simple to create in SutterPatch. Simply, if you can show it in a graph, there's a right-click menu that allows you to create the template. And so that can then be fed into the cell. So before I finish up here, I said that I wanted to talk a little bit about the alternative voltage signal source. The reason we put this in is oftentimes when people are defining an ion channel, they want to see what that channel would look like in voltage clamp. But as we've described, dynamic clamp works only in current clamp. So how can we do this? The way we've set this up is to allow the dynamic clamp module, rather than listening to the voltage of the head stage and creating that closed loop, we can instead have it listen to one of our aux out channels. In this case, for head stage one, it would be aux out three. You select this in the voltage signal source. Then in the routine editor, where you define your inputs and outputs, you can define a set of outputs to aux out three. And in this case, what I've got is a series of voltage steps where the cell is starting at minus 90 and then being stepped up to different steps for 20 milliseconds. This is what the dynamic clamp module is going to see, independent of the current that it puts out. How do we measure that current that it puts out? Well, if we have our cell attached to just a load resistor, a bath resistor, the bath setting on our model cell, since V equals IR, the voltage that we record in current clamp is going to be proportional to the current that we sent out through the dynamic clamp module. To illustrate how this worked, what we did was to define a 12-state sodium channel. This is based on a paper by Carter et al. Back in 2012, and ran it through a series of voltage steps as I defined. And these are the responses to those steps. We were able to produce an activation curve based on those. We also ran inactivation experiments. And what I did then was fit these data just using Igor's native curve fitting functionality. And in fact, these values that we ended up getting without any manipulation at all came within just a couple of percent of what was reported by that Carter et al. Paper. To conclude, what are the D-patch advantages for doing dynamic clamp? First of all, we've got a very powerful dynamic clamp engine. It's living out there in that FPGA in the hardware. It allows us update rates up to 500 kilohertz. Importantly, no third-party hardware is required. This comes, if you buy a D-patch, you have this available to you. We've got a number of different models available. Importantly, Hodgkin-Huxley models with up to 14 different states. Our dynamic clamp pools are easy to duplicate and transfer. And most importantly, I would say, is our dynamic clamp is completely integrated with our data acquisition software, which this means is that the settings that you have from the dynamic clamp are saved with your experimental data. So if you go back a year from now and say, oh, what equations did I use? It's right in there with the rest of the experiment, as are all of the other metadata that come with this experiment, such as your amplifier settings. And as I just described at the end, with our curve fitting, for example, there are powerful analysis tools that are readily available with Sutter Patch. With that, I'd like to thank you and hand it back to Telly, who's going to introduce Jan.
Thank you, Greg. Okay, next up, Jan Dulzer with his talk on combining experiments.
Thank you very much, Telly. And before I start, let me reiterate that we are taking questions, obviously, for the Q&A session at the end of the webinar. A few questions have already come in. I assume that a number more questions to Greg's talk will come in during my talk. What's important in for some questions, it's clear, but please indicate which speaker your question is directed to. It's better than guessing. Could it be this or could it be that? I will be talking about cross-experiment analysis. And here is what I will talk about today. First of all, I'll answer the relatively easy question, why do we need analysis across experiments at all? Then I will introduce metadata and how they streamline analysis. It's important to understand what metadata are and how we store them within Sutter Patch software and how we can review them as well, of course. Then I will introduce the data navigator and how we can use it to import Sutter Patch experiments into a single experiment, usually a, you can call it meta experiment, and how we can reconfigure the data tree to efficiently extract a subset of experiments or subset of data that we want to analyze together. Then we want to see how we can analyze replicates. And finally, I'll summarize that, and then we'll switch to the combined Q&A session. So why do we do cross-experiment analysis at all? We want to analyze experiments that are performed in a replicate. We are all scientists. That means we do science. We don't do an experiment once. We do it somewhere between 3 times and 500 times. And we want to analyze that efficiently across multiple experiments, which have similar or identical structures. So we do the same thing multiple times. If we don't do the same thing, we don't have statistics. We don't have multiple samples of the same data point. And eventually we want to collect those results in a single file, single result file. Let me quickly talk about the data structure in Sutter Patch software. That is mostly to understand the distinction between signal data and what we call metadata. What we define as an experiment would be the recording from either one cell or one preparation. It could be a tissue slice, could be a cell culture dish. And the routine, depending on what software you're used to, you may be used to calling this either a protocol or a pulse generator sequence, is the collection of a family of steps, for example, like you could use for a sodium IV curve, one or multiple input signals, typically several sweeps. And the parameters around this routine, the metadata, are actually recorded into what we call a paradigm. We create a container for this routine. This is not a standalone data file. We record that into a paradigm, and if you repeat the same routine multiple times, the temporal context is retained, and also when exactly which routine was executed. So this will be an experiment that starts by executing a routine. An alternative approach would be what we call planned paradigms, where you can execute a paradigm that, for example, runs a sodium IV, then determines the maximum current, for example, to go on to find the half inactivation potential in a second routine, and then chains to another paradigm that could be a dose response curve of a blocker TTX or whatever in our sodium example. And irrespectively of whether you use this approach, the planned paradigms, or the routine execution approach, what's interesting for the rest of the talk is what's in the paradigm. It's the metadata, and that's what we want to focus on. Metadata are stored either at the beginning of the paradigm, that could be hardware parameters, the computer, for example, what operating system am I running, what amplifier, what data acquisition am I running. It could be preparation details. What's the animal species, what genotype, or how was my sample prepared? And it could also be experiment descriptors like the test compound. Usually one experiment, one recording is one compound of interest that we're looking at. And then there's parameters that are stored during the experiment. For example, a solution exchange, we switch to a different solution, a new routine gets started, or the user adds a comment. All that gets stored to the metadata in the paradigm data. Metadata can either be automatically determined, like those hardware parameters. We know them, the software knows them, so no need for the user to enter them, or when a new routine gets started. Or they could be defined by the user, things like the preparation details, the experiment descriptors, or also, of course, the parameters like a comment or when a solution change happens. It's either manually tagged or if the solution switch is controlled through software, it would be there. Now, how do we enter the metadata? You either go through the menu, so the patch 7 metadata, you hit Control and 9, or if you have a Mac command at 9, or you use the dashboard button that brings up the metadata dialog. And here you have a number of groups, metadata groups. Here are the parameters associated with the respective group. And in this relatively simple view, the animal identifier is something that you could define automatically. You could increment that automatically with each experiment. You can have a prefix, mouse in this example, and you can start at some value and increment that by one for each experiment. And you also may want to confirm the ID before each experiment. You don't usually switch your experimental animal halfway through the experiment. Another parameter you might want to add is the weight. Is the age. In this case, that would be 16. And note that it's a numerical value only because the units, in this case, the days, you could also use the P or E terminology, should be stored separately so that you can analyze a numerical value independently of its unit. You don't need to parse the whole thing. For the stimulus, in this case, we want to enter something, my test compound for one experiment. Could be another test compound or a third test compound. That's the three test compounds that I used in the data that I generated for this presentation. If you don't find something in the metadata, a parameter that you would want to store, you may want to take a look at SetApatch Set Preferences metadata, where you can increase the detail level. It comes in three detail levels. The default is basic. That's only a subset of all the parameters. And full exposes all metadata parameters. You have a number more groups. And within each group, you have many more parameters. So for example, if you wanted to keep track of the glass that you use because you suspect that there's a difference between in this case, a 1.5 millimeter thick wall capillary and some other capillary, you can keep track of that as well. And if even in the full detail level, there's a parameter that you think is of general interest, let us know. It's no problem to add new metadata parameters. At one point, you may get confused of what parameters you defined. You can go to Show Summary. You see a list of all the parameters that you did define. And by double-clicking on one of them, that takes you right back to the set metadata parameter. So that's about defining the parameters. Now about reviewing them. There's a variety of ways. One is in the Review Scope, in the Scope window. You click on View Meta, and that opens the metadata review panel. And here is a tree structure that in this case shows you, here we have our mouse 16 days old, and here's our glass. And if you scroll down, the test compound in this case also is recorded at the routine level, assuming that the whole routine is under the influence of this particular test compound. One thing I want to mention is that we improved this appearance from what you have in the latest release version, 2.04. In 2.04, it's all white, and that makes it a little harder to read. So we improved the appearance. This will come in version 2.05. You can also review the metadata in the Data Navigator by clicking on the routine tree here and then clicking on the metadata link here. That will open a window similar to what you can access through the Scope window, again, a tree structure, and here you have your individual parameters. Now, the next step is combining experiments. if we have replicates of similar experiments, like in this example, what we want to do is we want to open the data navigator, click import, and navigate to the experiment that we want to import. For this example here, I have three experiments that I imported, and you end up with a tree that looks like this. The three experiments, obviously individual paradigms. There was only one paradigm per experiment, but how do we make sense of that? How do we sort that so that we can work with it? We click on build hierarchy and add the stimulus to the hierarchy, select the stimulus group and add the compound name to the build hierarchy. And we put it all the way up top. And that way what happens is we have a reconfigured data navigator tree that has the test compound on top level, my test compound, another test compound, and a third test compound sorted alphabetically. That's why it's upside down. And then of course you can open individual tree branches, and here you see the four routines that I recorded into this experiment that I imported here. And normally what you want to do is you want to batch analyze series routine data that were recorded with the same routine. So what you want to do is you want to add the routine name to the hierarchy. And that up here, there were two routines that I used in this example. One is the sample routine bowtie test. The other one is the sample routine IV. And here in the IV, I get all routines that were recorded with IV. And in my test compound, I would probably want to analyze all these in one batch. What's important is, and this is one thing that almost tripped me up when I prepared this, if the series group, the meta parameter group, and along with that, the parameter routine name isn't available, then you may need to increase the detail level. That's the slide I showed you earlier, the detail level of the metadata, because that's only available, I think, from the second level on. So next thing you want to do is you want to analyze the series, the routine data. You open it into the reanalysis scope window, you go to edit measurements, and then you select the last executed parameters. In this case, I made a modification of the original routine parameters from the sample routine IV that's in the sample routine pool. I modified it so that if I run the analysis, you only have the IV curve. By default, it would show you both an IV curve and a time course. The time course is not relevant in this case. And then what you can do is copy this to the layout by using the book scroll button there. And that creates a layout window that has the two signals and the results combined on one page. Then the next thing you want to do is add the analysis of another series. So you just run the analysis with the last executed settings, and that independently of what was done in that routine, applies the last settings. And again, you add that to the layout and you end up with the other two signals and the IV curve in the layout. And alternatively, what you can do is use the analysis editor, sort of patch analysis editor through the main menu, and also add an analysis from there. Again, you click on the book scroll, and here this is identical to the second IV curve, and you can simply drag them on top of each other. And note that this was new in version 204. In version 203, you would have a white opaque background of the IV curve, so you wouldn't see the one that's below. This is a quick and dirty way of comparing two IV curves, but you can get as sophisticated as you like. So here, for example, I combined the two current traces. In this case here, I had the capacitance compensation disabled. That gives me much greater capacitive transients, and that's what I measure in this model cell IV in essence. I make the step voltage a little smaller, but you can also get as fancy as you like with editing these Igor graphs. This is in essence just by right-click show this graph and then edit it. This is something that I edited in Igor itself, and that could be used for the publication already, maybe without the shadow. Some copy editors wouldn't like the shadow or some of that fancy stuff. So let me summarize what I told you today. metadata enable the efficient analysis. They enable it by giving you parameters that you can sort your data by. Metadata have value in being recorded together with the signal data in one electronic file. It's not a paper journal that gets stripped off your electronic data at some point. You can use the data navigator to group series according to parameters you're interested in. You can combine replicate experiments into one. And I showed you how to use the analysis in the layout window to create publication quality figures. And with that, let's start the Q&A session.
Thank you, Jan. So there is a number of questions that are waiting for both you gentlemen. Here's one for you, Greg. Your dynamic clamp system is impressive. I like the FPGA implementation. Do you occasionally run into problems regarding the alpha-beta formalization? I mean, there could be issues with the stability when the divider and the equations become very close to zero.
That's an excellent question. To the degree that we've been running these things so far, everything has been stable, but we have not extensively tested as many equations as I'd like to. And so, unfortunately, at this point, I have to actually answer, I don't know. I think one of the things is that because we're running at faster rate, it tends to be more stable because the instantaneous changes tend to be a lot smaller. But I think that if you want to get in touch with me separately with, you say, a specific set of equations, I'd be happy to test that out and we could see how that works.
Jan, here's a question for you. Do I need to re-enter the metadata parameters for each experiment, or do the previous values carry over?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. Of course, we don't want the users to have to enter all, well, I showed, I think, 8 or so parameters, but some users may enter tens or even hundreds of parameters, and we don't want to have them to re-enter those for each experiment. They are sticky. They remain there. But what that also means is be sure that parameters that may change from experiment to experiment are up to date, because the only thing that's worse than not having information is having the wrong information associated with your experiment. That is why we have the prompt feature that lets you review information that may change at the beginning of each experiment.
Great, thank you. Here's another one. Is it possible with your software to create multiple EPSGs with jitter so that they do not fall at the same time? For example, 20 hertz, but not perfectly phase locked.
It's definitely possible by using a segment in the stimulus waveform that you randomize in duration. We did not talk about that today. It seems like the asker is a little familiar with how the stimulus waveform is created. So you could have one segment in which you use an equation, and that would be a random number for the duration. And that would give it jitter, give it random jitter, or you could also use a list of values that you create randomly once, but then you use the same list of values all over. That would make it easier to analyze the data.
Great. Thank you, Jan. Greg, one for you. Can you use a presynaptic voltage signal to compute a synaptic conductance in the dynamic clamp?
We haven't developed that yet, but that is one of the main reasons why in that voltage source, the idea of being able to have the second head stage as being the source for the dynamic clamp. Again, that's an excellent kind of next step that we'd like to be able to develop and add in.
Another question that is actually for Greg, any chance ever of linking two dual head stage deep patch amplifiers? I know Sutter website says no, but in principle, ever?
I think the challenge is, yes, it is possible, and maybe someday down the line it will be. The challenge is we would have to definitely limit the acquisition speeds. I don't think you'd be able to bring in four channels at megahertz bandwidth if that's what you're after. until we have computers that can run and save data quite a bit faster than what we're at now. Telly, why don't you add to that?
So the underlying code in Sutter Patch can support actually up to 4 amplifiers, both D-Patch and IPA. As Greg said, the limitations would be the speed. At the bandwidth that the D-Patch runs, this would be quite a challenge, even for the very fast computers. That's a lot of data going across the USB 3 port. Like Greg mentioned, if the bandwidth requirements are less, then yes, it's something that we could probably look at and enable, but it would be, it nowhere can meet the full bandwidth of the hardware. Okay, who would like to tackle this one? What is so unique in your analysis software compared to the competitors?
I can take that one. I already showed a number of unique features. One of them definitely is the ability to store metadata directly in the data file and have it accessible, use it to group data, use it to sort data. Also the ability to create layouts, and that is publication quality figures. In essence, a lot of electrophysiologists do use EGOR to create their figures. We have application modules, we have the event detection module, we have the action potential analysis module, the single channel events. What else, Greg, do you want to chime in?
No, I think you've got the main ones, and then you've got all of the EGOR Pro functionality that's in there too.
And unique compared to PeakLamp is also the integrated data structure, where you do not have the equivalent of each routine data set as an individual data file, but you have everything kept together. That is similar to Patchmaster.
Okay, but I'll put one more comment regarding Patchmaster. As of my recollection, there is no mini analysis or single channel analysis actually built into Patchmaster. Those all require third-party applications. Okay, here's one that I guess I could tackle. Can Dendrite be driven by third-party software, for example, Axograph? The answer to that is no. Dendrite was developed just as a way for people to connect Sutter Patch or to use Sutter Patch with conventional amplifiers. All right, here's more coming in. Is Sutter Patch GLP compliant?
I think I can tackle that one. At this point, it is not. Well, hold on. Let me start over. The software product itself in general is never GLP compliant, at least not in the sense of CFR 21 Part 11. What is compliant is always the implementation in a particular lab. That means the validation of all procedures. Software can support GLP compliant operation, and Sutter Patch does that in many respects better than many. In the sense that we have the metadata, we can keep track of all sorts of parameters. And going forward, what we're planning to do is implement user levels that allow editing meta parameters depending on the user. And that would facilitate the GLP compliant installation and the validation of procedures within a lab. As I said, the product itself is never compliant. It's always the particular installation of a particular procedure in your lab.
Greg, here's a question. Can a D-patch and an IPA amplifier be linked, synchronized during a multi-recording experiment?
Not within the same instance of Sutter Patch. So from Sutter Patch, you can't run the two amplifiers at the same time. On the other hand, you can have multiple copies of Sutter Patch running, and you could have one running an IPA and one running a D-patch. I've done this. And then using the trigger out and trigger in BNCs on the amplifier to be able to have them time locked together. So yes, actually, the answer is yes. But again, you need two copies of Sutter Patch running.
I guess the other approach that I'm thinking of for that would be if you run a D-patch, since the IPA does have outputs for both the voltage and the current and has command input BNCs, you could drive it from the aux in and out.
Absolutely. But you would need one, right? You can't run them both from one copy of Sutter Patch.
Exactly. Correct.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But other than that, once you get past that, then absolutely you can have them one driving the other in whichever way you want to set it up.
But one thing we should probably say to that is you need a reasonably powerful computer. With the D-Patch, if it runs at full speed, we are in a situation that patch clamp electrophysiology hasn't been in for at least a decade and a half. That is the situation where you can acquire data fast enough to drive a computer against the wall. That's a situation that people who do imaging are used to, but that is definitely one factor. If you want to do sophisticated experiments like that, you do need the computing power associated.
Right. Or you need to slow down.
Exactly.
Okay, I think we've gone a little bit over our allocated time. So there are a couple of other questions that we will address by email. We'll leave the webinar running for anybody who wants to add any more questions that we could take offline. Again, I'd like to thank you for joining us today. And stay tuned for an email when the recording becomes available. Thanks again and have a great day or evening.